Dear God, we thank you for this day, this, as you be with pastors, he preaches this morning, Lord, to give him the words to say, that your words would come through him this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen.
So please have your Bibles open to Exodus 25, and we will be there for much of our time this morning, but we'll also, if you wanted to throw a bookmark or maybe the bulletin in John 6, we're going to spend some time there as well. And if as you know from our series, we've been looking at the different sanctuary scenes in Scripture, and we've moved on and we're into the tabernacle now, and we're looking at some of the elements, the furniture that is in the tabernacle that has been designed by God and set aside specifically for the purpose of worship to him. And so we're looking at the very specific construction that God has given and the details in Exodus 25. And last week we looked at the very first instrument or piece of furniture to be described, which was the Ark of the Covenant. And we thought it was interesting, the observation was made that God didn't begin with the tabernacle. He didn't say, start with the courtyard and then we're going to move in and this will be the altar and then this will be the holy place and this will be the Holy of Holies. He actually begins with the very center of the tabernacle complex, which is the Ark of the Covenant. He began with the Ark of the Covenant, not the tabernacle itself. So in the yet-to-be-described Holy of Holies, that once-a-year sanctuary for worshiping God on the Day of Atonement, God described and gave to Moses the descriptions for the Ark of the Covenant. Of central importance to God is how man, and specifically the high priest of the nation of Israel, would come before God with the Ark of the Covenant. So God began with the somber yet meaningful Day of Atonement sacrifice, which would be offered upon the Ark one day per year. So central importance, the primary position in the list of all of the tabernacle furniture was the Ark of the Covenant, which would be used one day a year in a very specific format. And we're going to move progressively outward this morning as we have the table of bread, the table for bread, and then the golden lampstand described for us in the rest of chapter 25 of Exodus. We'll look briefly, if at all, at the golden lampstand because we talked about that in some detail with the burning bush, the comparison between the burning bush and the golden lampstand. And each of these instruments are placed in the holy place, which is just outside of the Holy of Holies, or the most holy place. So the Ark of the Covenant last week was in the basically what we would call not the mathematical center of the temple, of the tabernacle, but the worshipful center. It was the once-a-year center of atonement when they would actually have the sins of the nation atoned for. And then we're moving outward. So you've got the Holy of Holies with that one instrument in it, the Ark of the Covenant. Now we're moving outward to the holy place, which was still designated and set apart. It still was cordoned off for specific use. And in that, we have the table of the bread. And I want to begin our time this morning by not reading from Exodus 25, but by reading from John 6. And the reason why I want to do that this morning, I want to kind of reverse the course we've taken in the last couple weeks by usually ending the time looking at how Jesus is the greater than. This morning, I wanted to set us up for seeing how Jesus is the bread that was presented in the temple on this table that we'll look at after this. And I want to start here in John 6 because this makes all the difference in the world for us in how we view what is symbolized in this morning's instrument, in the table of the bread of the presence of God. And so in John 6, we have the miraculous feeding of the 5,000. We're probably all quite familiar with the basics behind this setup, this scene in history. And there was 5,000 men, so not counting the women and the children. And they're on the coast of the Sea of Galilee. And as verse 2 tells us, this large crowd is following him, following Christ, because they've seen the signs he was doing in healing the sick. So he has gathered himself quite a following. You can heal the sick. I want to follow. I want to see what more this man, this guy who I'm hearing is maybe the savior of the world, I want to see what more he can do. I want to follow him. And I don't make fun of the crowd for doing that. I would have been right there with them. Like, this is a pretty amazing scene. We've not seen anything like this before, at least in this concentration. And so after, as the crowd gets hungry, they've collected 5 entire loaves for 5,000 men, not counting women and children, and 2 fish. Not exactly the old country buffet for 5,000. You would think you maybe could, a crumb here and a crumb there, and maybe, you know, you can have the lips of the fish and you can have the tail. And maybe we'll get enough to, so everyone can have just a nibble between their front teeth, and they will be just so satiated. But they actually feed. Jesus multiplies this food. This amazingly large crowd is fed with food left over. 12 baskets full to be exact. And after the feeding, knowing that the crowd is again amazed at what he had done, Jesus knows they will want to take him and make him king. Not surprising, wouldn't you? This guy needs to be the leader of our nation. He can multiply loaves and fish and feed thousands. We'll never go hungry again. He's healing the sick. Hail Jesus, let's make him king. That's what they were expecting in some of their minds anyways. So Jesus withdraws from the crowd, knowing that that's a propensity of the crowd, and he ascends a mountain to spend some time alone, a sermon unto itself. And then moving ahead, the following day, he and his disciples are now on the other side of the sea. I'd like to pick up reading in John 6:22. John 6:22 begins, "On the next day, the crowd that remained on the other side of the sea, where Jesus had fed them, saw that there had been only one boat there, and that Jesus had not entered the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Other boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. And so when the crowd saw that Jesus was not there, nor his disciples, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum seeking Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, 'Rabbi, when did you come here?' Verse 26, Jesus answered them, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves.'" He knows that their mind is set on their stomachs primarily. Verse 27, "Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" And verse 29, Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent." So they said to him, mind you, with stomachs still full of bread from the night before, "Then what sign do you do that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" I can't imagine Jesus' mind at this point, at the end of 30. "You're following me because I healed people. You saw a sign. You're following me to the other side of the sea because your stomach is full of bread and you probably want some more. And you're asking for another sign?" Really puts some power behind when he later would say that blessed are those who believe and have not seen. Because seeing isn't always believing, clearly here. I digress. Verse 31. Jesus continues, "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus then said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from the heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Verse 35, Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that is he has given me, but raise it up on the last day." Verse 40, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." This group here has been happy to have their fill of the bread, and yet missed the larger point, which is Jesus is the bread. And I fear if I was in the crowd that day, I probably would have been looking for the country spread and maybe some garlic powder and toasted over it. Maybe some more of that bread, Jesus. And what he wants us is to desire him. So may we spend some time in prayer before we spend the rest of our morning in his word. Father God, may we feast upon your word this morning. And because in the word we find and we see your Son, the bread of life, Jesus Christ. Father, may we not settle for croutons and saltines, but Father, may we feast on the full loaf that is Jesus Christ, who satiates, who satisfies our hunger, and who quenches our thirst. God, may we know that even though our stomachs rumble and our tongues stick to the roof of our mouths at different times in our lives, Father, may we spiritually desire and see in Christ the fullness of all that we should desire. So God, reorient our appetites to Jesus this morning. May we feast on him. Lord, may we see him as our all in all. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. I wanted to use that scene to set it up for what we're looking at with the table for the bread this morning, because the bread is ultimately the purpose of the table. Scholars basically agree that while the table of the bread described in Exodus 25 is hard to decipher, it has many of the same components that the Ark of the Covenant did, albeit not a box or a container. But there's no real explicit correlation between the table of the bread and anything else in the New Testament, the table itself. And then many scholars also agree that in Exodus 25, if you want to flip back there with John 6 in our minds, that verse 30 is the purpose for the table. Exodus 25, verse 30 reads, "And you shall set the bread of the presence on the table before me regularly." Now we see what the table was all about. The table was described in verse 23, "You shall make a table of acacia wood." It sounds very exactly like our Ark of the Covenant in terms of materials, same wood. 2 cubits be its length, a cubit its breadth, and a cubit and a half its height. So slightly smaller than the ark, still not some massive piece of furniture, quite diminutive in terms of all things temples that we think about the world. You see massive thrones and big gigantic statues, and here you've got this diminutive little table in the corner off to the side of this holy place. Verse 24 continues the construction description when it says, "You shall overlay it with pure gold and make a molding of gold around it," very similar to our ark. "And you shall make a rim around it, a hand breadth wide, and a molding of gold around the rim. And you shall make for it 4 rings of gold and fasten the rings to the 4 corners at its 4 legs. Close to the frame the rings shall lie as holders for the poles to carry the table." Once again, man would not touch the table. There's an element of holiness present here. Verse 28, "You shall make the poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold, and the table shall be carried with these. And you shall make its plates and dishes for incense, and its flagons," which is basically a pitcher, "and bowls with which to pour drink offerings, and you shall make them of pure gold." And then verse 30, "And this you shall set the bread of the presence on the table before me regularly." We know that every single part of the tabernacle system is being used to point people to God. Every part of it was meant to point people to God. Even on that one day a year, the Day of Atonement, when the priest, in his garments after being ceremonially washed, would go in with the blood of bulls and goats. All of it was meant to point to God and to Christ specifically. The regular and repeated sacrifices, the increasing level of holiness. You've got the altar, the holy place, the holy of holies, this increasing level of holiness. The strict procedures for approaching God. Everything was pointing to how sinful, fallen children of Adam could ever return to God. The way to the tree of life was forever guarded by the cherubim and the flaming sword. After the flood, I'm sure that was all gone. The garden was displaced. But prior to the flood, you could not even get near it, even if you took your sandals off. And here was a way for people to come back to God on God's terms. But the way back to God was open, yet strictly mediated through the covenant of God's own describing and choosing. Man was not just to walk up to God via the tabernacle willy-nilly and just say, "Hey God, what's up?" This was a very strict procedure, and the table for the bread of the presence was no different. It came with those specific instructions and had that clear purpose, to have the bread of the presence on the table before him regularly. And right away, we should recognize some common elements with the ark, the aforementioned acacia wood, but also the pure gold that is there. We have the 4 rings of gold and the gold-covered carrying poles, which would reside in the rings, and no human hands would touch the table to move it. But new to the table would be the inclusion of plates and dishes and pitchers and bowls. But what is interesting is what would later be described in Leviticus as a poured-out drink offering is here introduced but never would take place on the table. All drink offerings were poured out on the altar, but their utensils were stored here on the table. So you're starting to see that man would come a little bit more regularly into the holy place, not the Holy of Holies, come regularly before the bread of the presence. You're starting to see where you've got this increasing level of, well, now the priest can come. It's not just for the high priest. And you've got an element of man coming to God a little bit more regularly and being in his presence, because that's what the bread signifies. And then, of course, we've got that presence of God. The table, like the ark, had little major opulence, not downplaying, of course, the regality of pure gold, but this is nothing like those pagan temples devoted to human-conceived gods. The tabernacle, even itself, would be of modest size, and its instruments, while valuable, are largely modest. One author said that this building's true magnificence was its message, not its size. You could get an idea of the God to whom it was devoted by watching the priests and the high priests go about their daily and weekly and even annual business. And the table is used here to hold the bread of the presence before God regularly, verse 30 says. The table is called by other names throughout Scripture, which testify to that being its primary purpose. In Numbers 4:7, it's called the table of the presence. It was understood that that would be a depiction. The bread was a depiction of the presence of God. And in 1 Kings 7:48, it's called the golden table on which was the bread of the presence. What was important was not the table itself, but what sat upon it. Another table, another name by which the table is called in Leviticus 24 is the table of pure gold, where we're told how the table would function in the life of the tabernacle. So during Israel's 40-year wandering in Leviticus 24, we read that they had specific ways in which they were to present this bread before God. Not just to present it, but also to make it. I'll read from Leviticus 24, verses 5 through 9 here. You shall take the fine flour and bake 12 loaves from it. There's the bread of the presence. 2/10 of an ephah shall be in each loaf, and you shall set them in two piles, 6 in a pile, or your Bible may read rows, 6 to a row. And you put that on a table of pure gold before the Lord. And you shall put pure frankincense on each pile or row, that it may go with the bread as a memorial portion, as a food offering to the Lord. Every Sabbath day, Aaron shall arrange it before the Lord regularly. Following verse 30, place this bread before me regularly. It is from the people of Israel as a covenant forever, and it shall be for Aaron and his sons, and they shall eat it in a holy place, since it is for him a most holy portion out of the Lord's food offerings, a perpetual due. So we know that the table was used for that specific purpose. Construct this table for the mere purpose of holding the bread of the presence as well as the instruments for the drink offerings, the poured out offerings. And then we also now know from Leviticus 24 that 12 loaves were prepared. Unleavened bread, no mention of flour here. And they were placed in what can, or no mention of yeast. And they can be placed in what can be understood as two rows or two piles, each containing 6 loaves. These measurements would have resulted in cakes about 12 inches in diameter, about 4 inches thick. Now that our mouths are watering and we're looking for the country crock in the back. And I believe the number 12 is significant in Israelite culture. There were 12 tribes. And one potential understanding could be the 12 family-sized loaves were in the presence of God. Reminders are reminiscent of the fact that God is present with his people, Israel, all 12 tribes of them. And this bread would be in God's presence continually. And I would think in contradiction to pagan temples where food was offered so that the pagan god could be sustained, we have quite the opposite here. We don't have them offering food to God so that God could be sustained. If that were the case, then he is hardly a god. If that were the case, I would wonder what sustained him prior to creation in eternity past. Or is that why he made us, so we could be his bakers because he needs bread? Of course, that isn't the case. Nowhere are we told that this bread was considered to be for God's sustenance. And we are reminded from Leviticus 24 that the actions of Aaron and the priests would be that they received the food from God, and this was for his people, because it is a reminder that God provides, not the other way around. because our God is entirely and completely self-sustaining. We must not forget that. The God who loses not one iota of energy in sustaining this immense universe does not need bread from us to keep going. In fact, when we eat bread, we just generally get lethargic, don't we? It'd be counterproductive to have to feed God bread. Like, our universe would spin slower if we did that. God's got the carb overload going on right now. We need to give God a keto diet. So God is the unmoved mover of the universe, and this universe testifies to God's unending, unfading, and self-sustained power. And this bread is in God's presence, not on his plate for his consumption. And the other instruments of the table, being the pitchers and the bowls, would be used for drink offerings. But just as the bread was a picture of Jesus to come, so too are the drink offerings a picture of Jesus as well. And we'll briefly talk about that just because in Luke 22:20, when Jesus was instituting the Lord's Supper, he says, "This cup that is poured out for you is a new covenant in my blood." And each offering was often accompanied with a poured out sacrifice of drink offering. So these pitchers, these flagons, and the bowls would be used for that. They would be used to pour out a hin of wine along with the burnt offering that was given so that there would be an aroma. There would be a smoke. And you could say it would be a pleasing aroma to the Lord. And we even have in that a picture of Christ's covenant-cutting death to come. Oh, how I wish we talked about this last week before Lord's Supper. That would have been even better, but it didn't work out. Dear brothers and sisters, look and see that the tabernacle shouted that something permanent is coming. There wasn't one permanent fixture, outside of, we could maybe say, the gold, that wouldn't rot or decay. All of this was pointing to the fact that something permanent was coming. Acacia wood was quite sturdy, but it too would one day rot and decay, and even the temple would one day crumble. And these temporary signs were all pointing to a need for a permanent solution. And he has come. His name is Jesus Christ. And look at the inside-out focus, the inside-out focus of this. God started the inside, the once-a-year place for the atonement of the Day of Atonement at the Ark of the Covenant. He moved slightly outward to the table, which would have had weekly use in the bread. Aaron would bring, or the priest would bring the bread, refresh it every single week. So now we've got a once-a-week entrance into the holy place. But it also had daily use in that the drink offerings were stored on that table and were offered daily. God is showing us that he is our everything, our daily, hourly, and every second support and sustainer of life. God is not your once a week vitamin taken only on Sundays. God is your every moment sustainer. God is not your Christmas to-do list or your Easter only stop-off point. He is your every second giver of life. And the bread signified that as well. Bread would have been a key symbol for this nation, Israel. They were sustained with bread from heaven. This would have been a look back to what God has provided for them, when in his presence did he rain down manna from heaven. And he would provide for it so that they wouldn't even have to work on the Sabbath. So bread would have been a keen symbol for this nation. They were sustained by God's presence. The Lord didn't need bread. His people did, and God provided that. But bread also signified fellowship for this nation, because they would gather, they would sit, and they would break bread. A common euphemism for a joint meal. And we saw Moses doing that as with the nation before going up the mountain. And then we saw Moses, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and then the 70 elders, when they went farther up the mountain, they were given that amazing vision of the Lord's feet and the foot and the floor of the temple. And what did they do? They broke bread. They were allowed to eat and feast in God's presence. So God, in giving them this beautiful symbol of the bread of the presence on this table in the holy places, telling them that you can have fellowship with God. You can come into his presence. While mediated through a specific source, you can come into God's presence. That the flaming sword has maybe been kicked down a couple of degrees, and maybe the cherubim before the tree of life have been a little bit off guard because God is providing a way. He's calling them back from their duty a little bit. He's saying that there's going to be a time to come when my presence is available. It's available now, but now it's available strictly through my procedures and through this nation of Israel and through this covenant of blessings and curses. But oh, the covenant of grace is coming. This bread of the presence would have magnificent imagery for them and for us. When we read of this in Exodus 25, when you're going through your Bible reading, don't just gloss over it. Look at it and see Christ. He is our presence. Oh come, Emmanuel. I just screwed that up, didn't I?
A little bit, yeah.
Do it for us, Kathy.
No. Oh come, Emmanuel.
And what does Emmanuel mean?
God
with us, the bread of presence. This is all pointing to Christ to come. The nation of Israel saw that this bread would have major significance. And the continual and regular presentation of the bread of the presence was a reminder to the nation that God was still providing for his people. And he provides them what they need, not necessarily what they want. They needed food while wandering in the wilderness, and God provided that, but what do they want? Egyptian cucumbers, leeks, melon, and fish. Why did we leave Egypt? To have this manna when we could have had cucumbers and melons and leeks and fish, hopefully in separate dishes. So God provides what you need, not necessarily what you want, because we often have wrongly operating wanters. And because they didn't realize what they needed was him, not the security or food of Egypt, the ruling of Pharaoh or the food of the region, they needed God. They didn't rescue themselves, they didn't save themselves, they didn't even sustain themselves. They were continually and utterly dependent upon God. Look at the rescue from Egypt and tell me what they did to accomplish that. Apart from walking in obedience, nothing. God saved them, God rescued them, God parted the sea, God brought them into the promised land. Even in the face of their amazing disobedience, God still provided a way. Yes, it cost them 40 years, but it could have been, wipe them all out, I'm done. God provided for them. God sustained them. And this bread of the presence is also a picture of that. And dear brothers and sisters, you didn't rescue yourself. You didn't save yourself. And you don't even sustain yourself. In the prayer that Jesus, God himself, taught us, he said, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily leeks, cucumbers, melons, and fish. Give us this day our daily bread. Daily, regular bread." Oh, the beautiful significance of this table. Yes, it's a great title for a devotional publication, but how often do we let our familiarity, and if we're honest with ourselves, our spiritual laziness, allow us to stay in the rut of what will always be our daily bread and not feast on our daily bread? Yes, you work, or if you're retired, worked hard for your income, and yes, you were prudent in storing some away for rainy days or for days when your body could no longer perform those regular tasks. And yes, you've made provisions for food, shelter, clothing in the future, but we must never pat ourselves on the back because God has graciously provided or overabundantly provided for our needs. Please allow me to read from an article, and it's a paragraph that I found helpful. It's a bit long, so I'm asking for your attention. And this was helpful for this time in our word when we think about the daily bread of God and how we can so often just think that, well, what's going to be will always be. This article begins, "Do we rise in the morning and grumble and mutter under our breath about how much we dislike our jobs? Do we complain because our house is not big enough or the cars we drive not new enough? When we sit down to eat, do we begin to engorge ourselves, giving little to any thought to the source of our meal? Perhaps in an agrarian society it was easier to be more grateful for a meal. For example, a farmer would have to till the soil, plant the seed, fertilize, water, and wait for the crop. Or the farmer would have to raise the calf, feed it, care for it, slaughter it all before he could eat it. Naturally, agriculture and animal husbandry visually depended upon the providence of God. If there is no rain, there are no crops. And if there are no crops, then there is no food for man or animal. And just because we stroll down the aisle of our air-conditioned grocery store and load our shopping trolleys with food does not mean that we ought not to give thanks for our daily bread. Whether we sit for a meal, drive in our car, or go to work, we should give thanks to our gracious Heavenly Father for providing us with our daily bread.
close quote. I was convicted. I don't live in England, so I don't call it a trolley, but when my cart can get full, with little thought to much other than the PIN code I got to enter to make the funds come out of my bank, if the chip card is working rightly. So I was convicted. I was hit by that. But those are tangible things. And I think that's helpful for us. That's a great application for us in this, that God does provide for us our daily bread. What we need, not often, or always what we want. And so often, nearly every day of my life, has he provided for those things overabundantly. I literally have never wanted or have gone without food. I know some of you can't say that. I've literally never not gone without food. I knew at any point I could eat something at any point of the day, unless I was in the car and the gummy bears were gone or something. But there has never been a time where I haven't known I was going to get another meal. There's never been a time where, sure, sometimes as I grew quickly, the clothes got a little bit high water, but my clothes never got threadbare. Sometimes there were iron-on patches. That was more because, you know, we slide as kids and we do things on our hands and knees. It's never happened as an adult. Tells you a lot about how I spend my day. The elbows maybe wear out from the recliner. I've never wondered if the roof over my head would hold up or if I would even have a roof over my head. God has overabundantly provided for me, and I've basically 99.9% of the time have taken advantage of that. And then before I eat, dear God, thank you for this food. In Jesus' name, amen. Like, God is like, oh, thank you, Mike. So heartfelt. You're so appreciative, Mike. You went through the motions, Mike. And he provides for my daily bread every single day, and that's not a guarantee. Those are tangible things. God speaks to us through tangible things. That's why we have baptism. That's why we have the Lord's Supper. God uses his creation. Romans 1 tells us creation testifies that he's there. So I'm not going to downplay tangible things, as important as they are, because there are people in this world that don't have every single thing I've just listed. And I don't say that callously. Those are very important things. That's why I love mercy ministries like Operation Christmas Child or different adoption programs abroad or locally. They're very important, and God thinks so as well. But they're not eternally important, because God cares for all people, but not at the expense of their souls. In fact, I would argue that going without often brings a greater reliance upon God. In the few times of mild going without, has that ever caused me to rely on him all the more? It makes me wonder, this is a dangerous prayer or thought to have, it makes me wonder why he doesn't do it more often. Why not remove some of those provisions so that I rely on him all the more? Which is why the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. I can love my tangible things and my tangible needs, which can also then cause me to become reliant upon myself for sustenance and not upon him outside of a casual prayer before eating. So if we end up taking the tangible for granted, then how much easier it is to take the spiritual things for granted. And that is Jesus' larger point in John 6. He tells the massive crowd which chased him down on the other side of the Sea of Galilee, "Do not work for food that perishes, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him, the Son of Man, God the Father, has set his seal." This is classic, "Don't store up your treasures in heaven" speak here. It's just another way to say that. Moths and rust will destroy. Store up your treasures in heaven, where even thieves can't steal them. Here was that crowd with bellies still full of fish and bread, miraculously provided for the thousands there from just 5 loaves and 2 fish. And they ask, "What sign will you do? What work will you perform, Jesus?" Bills are paid. Stomach's full. What work will you perform, God? Oh, Mike. Maybe you should go without, so you can wake up and see that I am the bread of life. I'm trying to learn the lesson through this sermon so that he doesn't. But I'll thank him if he does. Because I'll need it. Because are not your and my bellies relatively full here this morning? You're literally, he's speaking to the crowd here, and this is paraphrasing, you're literally digesting a byproduct of the work I just performed. You're in carb overload, and you're asking, "What will I do?" Jesus is thinking, maybe, the nerve, the gall. But how often have I, with full belly, not thanked the God who filled it? Jesus stuns this spiritually listless crowd, for the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Y'all are looking for bread for your stomachs. You're sidetracked by appetite, and the bread was just a picture for them in Moses' day and for us today. The true bread, the bread that counts, is the bread of eternity, which is Jesus Christ. Verse 35, Jesus starkly says in John 6, he just plainly says, Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Make no mistake about it. That bread I just gave you yesterday on the other side of the sea was a picture of me. It miraculously came down from heaven through no work of your own. How did Jesus come down from heaven? Miraculously through no work of a human. Mary was overpowered, was overshadowed by the Holy Spirit in which she was given Jesus in utero, fully human the entire time. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Jesus is the real sustenance that we need. How great is it if you have a full belly and die and go to hell? That's the message that Jesus says to them. You want more bread. I'm the bread of life. And without me, you're going to hell with a full stomach. That was what would capture their attention. So you died without a hunger pang? I'd rather die threadbare, bone thin, homeless, and in physical anguish than live without Jesus Christ. Sure, I'd complain, probably hourly if not more. Ask my family, they will attest to the truthfulness of that statement. I do complain with the slightest hunger pang, or sliver in my finger, or hole in my pants. But physical comfort is nothing without Christ.
I met a man 3 weeks ago who showed that and said that, puking his guts out with pancreatic cancer, and he could say, I know where I'm going when this is over. He preached a better sermon that afternoon than will ever come out of my mouth. I'd rather die threadbare in continual anguish than live a day without Christ. Feast on the bread of God. My eternal thirst, my eternal hunger is satiated. I'm glad Leslie's and Tom aren't here this morning. And the bread of heaven, Jesus Christ, makes some more shocking statements towards the end of this chapter. In verse 37, he says, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. He is the bread that satiates your hunger, who provides for eternity, and he will not cast you out. All that the Father gives to him, he keeps. Hear those words carefully. God draws people in. God calls them to come to Jesus Christ. And if you have been, he, Jesus Christ, will never cast you out. Like the 12 loaves of bread continually before the Lord in his presence, never cast out. Jesus, the true and greater bread, will never cast out those who come to him. The comfort of those verses is stupendous. Maybe you're hurting tangibly. Maybe you're struggling with illness, with pain, with financial difficulties. And yes, please hear this morning that God cares about those things. But if you're his, he has you, and you are secure. That hasn't slipped underneath his radar. He's not unaware of those things. He's either causing them or allowing them for a purpose to bring you closer to who he is. It's also not a sign of your insecurity in him, but you are secure in him because God the Father has given you to Jesus, and Jesus himself says he will not cast you out.
Please don't listen to the lie that says if you're experiencing those things, you don't have enough faith. Jesus then says he is here to do the will of his Father. And in verse 39, he tells us his Father's will is that I shall lose nothing of all that is given to me, but raise it up on the last day. And in there is great eternal hope. And there is the satiation of your eternal hunger and thirst. And that is why you will never hunger and thirst in terms of your eternal hope. Jesus will raise you up on the last day. Oh, the glory of that. The will of God continues, and Jesus says in verse 40 of John 6, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." Three times directly and three more times indirectly, Jesus refers to himself as the bread from heaven. Dear brothers and sisters, feast on the Lord Jesus Christ. Feast on the manna of his will, which is found in his word. Go to the banquet table of his presence every single day. Not out of duty, but out of need for satiation. Feed on Jesus Christ. Look into his word. Chew on it. Discover who God is in his word. Don't treat it like a crouton or a little cracker to nibble on. But feast on him. Go to his word. You don't go to his word alone. He promises the Holy Spirit. He promises understanding eventually. You may have to read passages 40, 100, maybe ever to get to the meaning. But God promises that he will feed you and he will satisfy you. Maybe you need to go to Jesus for the first time. Maybe you need to have that hunger and that thirst satiated for the first time. Go to him. Look upon the bread of the presence, the Emmanuel, the God with us, Jesus Christ, the one who, as the song said, stood in our place. And in that is amazing grace to provide us an eternal home where we will never hunger or thirst or be in pain or experience sorrow again. Or be homeless, or be without lights or heat, and where our every spiritual need will be met in full. Let's pray. Gracious God, we are so thankful that we stand now not having to look at a tabernacle as glorious and as significant as that was, but Father, we look to Jesus. We look to the bread of life. Father, we thank you that you've given us your Son and that his body was broken, that his blood was spilled for us. The amazing grace and the amazing mercy of Christ standing in our place where we should stand before you, Father. He took that and bore it upon himself. And that is mercy and that is grace. Father, may we never lose, or when we find that our appetite is waning, may we go to you in repentance and prayer, and may we ask you to enliven our appetites again for Christ. Father, we know that the regularity of life can sometimes pull us into ruts. We know that we're not informing you of that. You're well aware of that. We've seen it on display here in John 6. But Father, may we not be always like those bread-seeking followers of Christ to have their stomachs filled, but Father, may we be feasting on his bread spiritually every single day. What better use of our time could there be, Father, than to set our days feasting on you? God, we love you and we thank you for giving us your Son. Father, we thank you for opening up the way of salvation. We can turn from our own lives and our own sins, and we can turn to the perfect work of Jesus Christ, confessing our sins, knowing that you're just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Father, we thank you for giving us Christ. May we ever and always feast on the bread that is the bread of life. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.